Doesn't the choir sound good tonight? How many of you are glad that you're in the house of the Lord? Good looking crowd on a Wednesday night. I'm glad that God put a canopy over us, and that way that it wasn't raining too bad out there. But I'm thankful that the Lord is good, and I just want to brag on this real just 1 second. I was close to having my life taken from me last night, but God stepped between me and a tree. And I'm just glad to be here. I'm glad he allowed me to be part of this meeting because I enjoy it. I enjoy going to church with God's people. And why don't you give God some praise right now if you're glad you're here. Amen. Amen, amen. Is there a pastor on the main floor here close I can see? Can you throw your hands up, pastors? Where you at? Let me see. Okay. I'm just making sure. I was wondering where they's all at tonight. They're hiding in different places. Come on, preacher. I want you to pray right now. Come on. I want you to open up this service for us. Brother Chuck, won't you give him a hand as he's coming? And I'm going to tell you something. Brother Chuck, he'd been faithful to support this meeting for a number of years. And through the time, let me tell you what God did. He ain't always been a preacher. It was about last year, year before, 2 years ago during the meeting. And he answered the call to preach. And I'm so thankful for that. We're going to ask him to pray for us right now as we bow our heads.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, as we bow, God, in the name of your darling Son, Jesus Christ. Father, so grateful, Lord, for this another blessed opportunity, God, together with brothers and sisters in Christ, that we might worship your holy name above all things. Father, we ask you now for the anointing upon this service tonight, dear God. Lord, we pray, Lord, that through this service, God, that you'd be blessed above all things. Father, you'd be pleased, God, with each part of this service. Father, we ask for the drawing of the Holy Spirit of God, Lord, upon that one that might be here lost tonight. That, Father, they'd leave, dear God, anew, Lord, refreshed in Christ, born again by the blood of Jesus. God, we now ask you to bless the McCamies tonight in a special way, Lord. Anoint them, Father, and Lord, Brother Byers, he preaches the Word of God. Father, open our hearts that we might receive it with gladness. Father, that lives might be changed here tonight. Lord, ask your blessings upon this church, Brother Chris, this church family. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Brother Kelly's got a word for you.
I want you to tell God is real. This morning about 5 o'clock on 64, I hit a big tree that was in the road at 55 miles an hour. My car is totaled. I turned completely around, I don't know how many times, facing back towards Hayesville. But I went to the hospital, and I'm good. I got checked out. God is good. God had a hold of me.
Amen.
He had the will.
What about that? Well, we both had an accident on 64 last night. Sing it out, choir. Holy Ghost. Amen. Sing that second verse again, choir, and sing it like you mean it now. Hey, everybody's warmed up. Let's worship tonight. Come, everything you give will go to support the meeting. And I began to think about that. Boy, if 100 people just gave $100, the meeting would be paid for tonight. That's all it takes. If you're watching online and you want to give, you go to HaysvilleFreeWill.org and you can give there. It's tax deductible to you. If you make a check out tonight, you make it out to First Free Will Baptist Church. But every penny you give will go into this meeting. If we have excess of funds after the meeting, then we'll roll it into next year. All right? If everybody agrees with that, raise your right hand. Say amen. Amen. All right, it's approved.
Boy, ain't God good. Let's pray. Lord, the most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, we come into your presence tonight. We know we don't deserve to be here either. But God, by the grace of God and the blood of Jesus, we have this great privilege to call on you tonight. And God, to ask you for your help tonight in the service, to help the singers, to help the preachers. And God, we just pray tonight, help us all to worship you and to be obedient to you. And that one that may be here lost tonight, I pray that you draw them out of the flames of hell and out of sin and of the curse and of the guilt of their life and bring them into the very presence of God tonight. Oh, by your divine grace and power. And Lord, tonight we just come to honor you and worship you and adore you and love on you tonight with all that is in us. God, may we honor our precious Savior. And God, tonight we ask you to bless this offering, that all of it go forth, Lord, unto your glory, for the souls of man may be saved by the grace of God. And Lord, we'll give you the honor and the privilege and the glory for it all. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh,
praise the Lord. Look to your neighbor and tell them they look good tonight. Can you do that? There you go. It is an honor to have this group. I grew up listening to them. Matter of fact, the leaders of this group started in 1954. 65 years of singing Southern gospel bluegrass music. And let me tell you something. Get a hold of this. I think that this kind of music is something that helps change hearts and souls. Not only that, I think that we need to have it more in our area because it's good. Amen. I want you to make welcome tonight like you've never made them welcome before. From the great state of Tennessee, would you make welcome the McCamies?
Hearts that hunger for the truth. Bearing precious seed, we go out to sow with joy, knowing that God's word won't return to Him void. To the fertile field of the world that's lost in need, we go forth in the power of the Lord, bearing precious seed. And the sunshine as we watch the harvest grow. We'll keep praying as we're planting, reaching to the uttermost. Bearing precious seed, we go out to sow with joy, knowing that God's word won't return to Him void. To the fertile field of the world that's lost in need, bearing precious seed. Bearing precious seed, we go out to sow with joy, knowing that God's word won't return to Him void. To the fertile field of the world that's lost in need, we go forth in the power of the Lord, bearing precious seed. To the fertile field of the world that's lost in need, we go forth in the power of the Lord, bearing precious seed.
Cheryl's singing for you tonight. Be brave. If Ephesians chapter 6. Put on the whole armor and stand.
I know the pain of prayers that go unanswered, and I wrestle with what's practical and when I must have faith. But greater is the one who lives in me. So I'll stand on the promises He's made. So I'll be brave, I'll be strong, sharing the gospel until the whole world knows that Jesus lives and He still saves. And He'll fight the battle for us any day. Be brave.
Now victory for the battles won't come easy. So put on your armor, valiant soldier, praying all the time. Some days it may seem easy to surrender, but you'll never win if you give up the fight.
So be brave, be strong, the whole world knows that Jesus lives and He still saves. And He'll find the battle for us any day. So be brave, be strong, sharing the gospel until the whole world knows that Jesus saves, and you'll fight the battle for us any day. Be brave, be brave.
Amen. So good to be here tonight. It's good to be in revival. I'm so thankful for revival. What a joy to be here. Reuben will sing for you a song that's called Something Worth Saving. Aren't you glad that he saw something worth saving in you?
Amen. Yes. Amen.
Why the Lord saved me, why He would grant me repentance and faith to believe. And I wondered why He reached down so low for just one old sinner. Well, I suppose He must have seen something no one else could see. He must have seen something worth saving that day He reached down and forgave me. He must have known how happy this wretched old sinner would be. And though I fear I'd never be worthy, my God is real and so is His mercy. He must have seen something worth saving when He saved me. Now Not one single day goes by that I don't fail him. But I'm so glad that he's faithful and just to forgive. And there's no way that I can hope to ever repay him. So I'll just keep singing his praises as long as he lets me live. He must have seen something worth saving that day he reached down and forgave me. He must have known how happy this wretched old sinner would be. And though I feel I'd never be worthy, my God is real and so is his mercy. He must have seen something worth saving when he saved me. Isn't it good when we just look back and remember when he came by and gave us that special invitation to become a child of God? I'm glad I'm saved tonight. Not of what I've done, but what he did for me. It's been an honor just to be here. It would be worth it just coming down here for the prayer room. Absolutely. For the prayer room. Took me back when I was just a little boy. And I could hear all the preachers when they had a revival. When they had a revival, everybody showed up. I mean, they just came. But you hear them off down in the woods about a half hour before church time. They're ringing the prayer bells of heaven, talking to the Lord. And it took me back in this little prayer room back here tonight. The times that I can remember that. And most likely if I'd listened close, I'd probably heard my dad or my grandfather, somebody call my name out to him. Bless my soul. And he did. And I'm glad I know him tonight. And I trust that you do. We're going to do our best just to brag on him a little while, okay?
So easy when life's at its best, but it's down in the valley, amen, of trials and temptation. That's when faith is really put to the test.
For the God on the mountain is still God. Yeah.
Eli's singing for us tonight, more like Jesus and less like me.
Lord, I love you, and I'm part of you. You know the things I'm longing to be. I hope that it's showing. I want to be growing more like Jesus and less like me.
Lord, when you saved my soul, I was no prize, I know. You had to mold me and show me the way. And I'd been through times so bad, lost all the joy I had. Now there is something I'm trying to say.
Lord, I love you, and I'm part of you. You know the things I'm longing to be. I hope that it's showing. I want to be growing more like Jesus and less like me.
And I have come through the fire, burning with one desire. Lord, purify me and help me to see. Just like pure gold refined, I can be made to shine, be more like Jesus and less like me.
Lord, I love you, I'm part of you. You know the things I'm longing to be. I hope that it's showing. I want to be growing more like Jesus and less like me. Lord, I love you, I'm part of you. You know the things I'm longing to be. I hope that it's showing. I want to be growing more like Jesus and less like me. More like Jesus and less like me. More like Jesus and less like me.
Preacher got up and said, stand to your feet. We'll start with a prayer. If you have a need, let it be heard, saints, let it be known. We're all family and you're not alone. That's when he saw her in the back of the church. Her silence and sadness cried out the hurt. The kind shepherd knew just what to say. I need to know before we can pray. An unspoken request.
Does anybody have one here tonight? Did you come with a burden you can't share, a need in your life?
Just lift up your hand to the one who can give you rest. Child, have no fear,
our God can hear.
An unspoken request. The preacher whispered as she raised her hand, sweet Holy Spirit, come by her and stand. And as her tears started flowing, there was no doubt that in the throne room of heaven, her secret was out. An unspoken request.
Does anybody tonight, did you come with a burden you can't share, a need in your life?
Just lift up your hand
to the one who can give you rest.
Child, have no fear,
our God can hear.
An unspoken request. Child, have no fear,
our God can hear
an unspoken request.
All right, go ahead, Eli. Recommend him tonight to you, and we'll close with this number, There Is Jesus. I hope you see him tonight. Amen. We need to, don't we? Amen.
It had been 3 days.
His parents couldn't find him. But the scribes and the Pharisees were all gathered round him as a boy in the temple, speaking with such wisdom. They were all amazed at what he said. And in the middle of it all, there was Jesus. The one crying in the wilderness, John the Baptizer, spoke of one who was to come baptizing with fire. When John baptized him, the heavens were opened, and
God descended like a dove.
Ain't it good to know how it feels? Heavenly Father, He owns everything. How does it feel to know You are loved by the One who created the stars up above? How does it feel to know you're all right when you lay your head on your pillow each night?
I know that it's real. Ain't it good to know how it feels?
Ain't it good?
Ain't it good to know how?
Did you enjoy the McCameys tonight?
Love you, man. Amen.
Wonderful job. Love you guys.
Well, praise the Lord.
Love you, honey. Amen.
I'm glad I know how it feels.
Amen.
I want you to make welcome tonight. He's my friend. He works with Evangelistic Outreach Ministries from Portsmouth, Ohio. I want you to make welcome Brian Baer.
Love you, buddy. Thank you. Oh, I I'm very humbled. Did my mama ask you to do that? I know they're watching tonight. They're suffering down in Florida for about 6 weeks. And so that's what I guess people do when they get older. They go south when they live in Ohio. So it's much better for them physically wise. So I know they're watching tonight and they're praying for me. I know that because mommy texted me today. I still call her mommy. I'm 43 years old, but it don't matter. And just deal with it if that offends you. But I call her mommy and I said, thank you, mommy. And I feel her prayers tonight. And I feel my mamaw's prayers. I feel my wife's prayers, my children's prayers. And I feel your prayers. Whew. Good to know how it feels. Amen. Son. Wow. I love the McCameys. Don't you? Don't you love them? Love them so much. I realize they announced that this is their final year touring. They're not done yet. They're just done touring. But they're not done till God says they're done. But we know that the years, the miles, it's hard to say how many million miles they've traveled, just ministering the gospel of Jesus Christ. Songs that will forever go down as some of the greatest ever to be sung in churches. And I have my own personal testimonies of how their songs have been a help and encouragement to me over the years. And that last one was one of them that's nearest to my heart. And, you know, when you grow up and you hear that kind of music and then I hate to say this because this won't sound right, but when I was young, my idols, I guess it's the wrong word, but the people I looked up to, they were Southern gospel singers. That's what I thought I was going to be when I grew up. That's what I wanted to be. That was my heart's desire. And so every Sunday morning going to church, we put in a cassette. Now, kids, you have no idea what that is. But we put in cassettes, and we put on McCameys Live, and going to a meeting. My land, what great albums, and albums, they don't know what those are either. But what great memories. And then, you know, you look up to them, and you think, well, if I ever meet them, you know, they'll never, you know, you just think people are just above you, and they're not down to your level, and they won't be kind, or, you know. But then when you finally meet them and realize they are who they're, just the real, down to earth. Most of all, they love the same Lord you do. And instantly when we met him, we fell in love with him. And I'm so glad we've had several meetings with him and will again this year. And it's just good to have them with us. Good to be here. This is my very first time preaching at the First Free Will Baptist Church of Hayesville. I've been here on several occasions. And so, Chris, you know, I'm actually pinch hitting tonight, but I'm glad to be a pinch hitter. That means I'm still on the team. Amen. Amen. I've spent my life always ready to do just about anything, and I'm willing and ready just to do about anything. And so I'm here tonight representing the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And I thank you for your prayers. I thank you for your friendship. We've fallen in love with these people. When I first came here in the old church with Mike and Teresa Blanton singing a weekend meeting, I never thought I'd ever get here, number one. And then two, I never thought we'd ever be able to find our way back out. And I still don't know that, to be honest with you. But I'm so glad that God has just allowed your pastor and myself to be the dearest of friends throughout the years. And tonight I knew what I was going to preach before I came here. The Lord settled it in my heart days ago. And I want you to turn your Bibles, if you have them, to Genesis chapter 42. Genesis chapter 42. Genesis chapter 42. We'll begin reading in verse 1. You can stand. That's fine. Stretch your legs a little bit. Genesis chapter 42. We'll begin reading in verse 1. Genesis 42. Begin reading in verse 1. Now when Jacob saw that there was corn in Egypt, Jacob said unto his sons, "Why do you look one upon another?" And he said, "Behold, I have heard that there is corn in Egypt. Get ye down thither and buy for us from thence, that we may live and not die." And Joseph's 10 brethren went down to buy corn in Egypt. But notice the fourth verse. But Benjamin, Joseph's brother, Jacob sent not with his brethren, for he said, lest peradventure mischief befall him. And the sons of Israel came to buy corn among those that came, for the famine was in the land of Canaan. Notice again with me the first part of verse 4 for our text verse tonight. But Benjamin, Joseph's brother, Jacob sent not with his brethren. I'd like to preach on this subject tonight, letting go of Benjamin. Letting go of Benjamin. Thank you. You may be seated. Letting go of Benjamin. There's an old story. It's been told probably from this pulpit, and you probably have heard it. But there was a young boy that had got his hand stuck in a vase at his house. And it was a priceless vase. And they tried every single way his parents did to try to lubricate his arm. They tried to do everything he can to get the vase unstuck from his hand. But they finally came to the conclusion that they were going to have to break this priceless heirloom in order to get his hand free. But there really was no price too high. They wanted to make sure the kid was safe and everything would be all right. So they tried their best to break the vase and to make sure that they wouldn't injure the child. And so when they broke the vase, they found that the son had his hand in a fist. That's why he couldn't get there. It's why they couldn't remove his hand from the vase. And when he opened the vase, they found that he had a penny inside that vase. And the reason why he wouldn't pull his hand out is because he was afraid of losing the penny. So he was holding on to that penny, and they actually had to sacrifice that priceless heirloom just to get his hand free, when all he had to do was to just let go of the penny and everything would have been okay. And you say, "Well, Brian, what does that have to do with our verse tonight?" There are folks under my sound of my voice tonight, and I'm sure maybe listening or by streaming, that are holding on to some things that are preventing you from getting full victory with Jesus Christ. There are some of you tonight that feel like you're a bother to God, and say, "Well, I don't want to bother him with my little problems." Well, can I just say this right away before we go any further? What matters to you matters to God. And if he says, "You can cast all your cares upon me because I care for you." And he said, "My yoke is easy and my burden is light." What that literally means is, it doesn't matter what you are carrying tonight. It doesn't matter how heavy the load may be. You can throw it on Jesus because he can handle it. Now, I got news for you tonight. You cannot handle what you're holding on to. You cannot handle what you're going through. You cannot handle the sin in your life. You cannot handle the burdens in your life by yourself. You're going to need someone to help you. And the only way you're going to be able to receive help is to let go of what's holding you back. And in our text verse, we find that Jacob, there was a famine in the land. And he found and heard that there was corn in Egypt. Now, I got to just get you up to speed very quickly. We know that he had another son that he loved very well. His name was Joseph. And we all know the story of Joseph and the coat of many colors. And so now Joseph is in Egypt. He is already worked his way up into second in command under Pharaoh. What I love about Joseph is every point in his life, from the pit to the prison to the palace, the Bible says, and the Lord was with him. Every step that he took was ordained. I feel the Lord tonight. Every step that he took was ordained by the hand of God. And so now Joseph was second in command under Pharaoh. And so Jacob sent his other sons, but the Bible says he sent not Benjamin. Why? Because Benjamin was Joseph's blood brother. He was born to the mother that he loved, that Jacob loved the best. Her name was Rachel. And so Rachel had two sons, Joseph and Benjamin. And so basically Jacob held on to Benjamin because he didn't want to let go of the thing that he loved the most. He'd already lost one son, and so what Benjamin represented was fear. What Benjamin represented was doubt. What Benjamin represented was deception. What Benjamin represented was everything that he thought was a part of his life, and so he did not let Benjamin go. So the Bible says that the brethren went to Egypt to buy corn, and so you all know the story. Joseph, by this time, his appearance has changed, and when they got to him, he knew who they were, but they had no idea who he was. And so we find in the next few chapters that Joseph actually played a little trick on them. And so he put some money in their bag, and he sent it back home to them. And he asked them some questions while they were there. And he found out, number one, that his brother was still alive. And he found out, number two, that his father was still alive. And so basically what he said was, you know what? I'm going to keep one of your brothers here. You go back, and if you're going to come back this way and get anything for me, you're going to have to bring Benjamin back with you. And so they went back home, and they testified to their father Jacob and said, listen, we ain't going to be able to get any corn. We ain't going to be able to live. We're going to die unless you let go of Benjamin. And so the Bible says that Jacob willingly let Benjamin go. And you say, well, Brian, well, what does that have to do with me? Well, you got to know the rest of the story. Because he let go of Benjamin, thank God he was able to receive so much more than what he ever thought possible. You say, well, Brian, what does that have to do with me? I'm so glad you asked again, because some of you are holding on to some things tonight, when just over the hill, God's got some things prepared for you that will blow your mind. He's got some things ready for you that'll cause you to do exceeding abundantly above what you can ask or think, according to the power that worketh in you. But you will never get it unless you let go of Benjamin. Number one, I want you to notice, Jacob would have never gotten the reward if he had not let go of Benjamin. He would have never gotten the reward unless he let go of Benjamin. You say, well, Ryan, what was the reward? Go with me in chapter 45 if you still have your Bibles open. If not, they'll put it on the screen for you. Chapter 45. Chapter 45. Chapter 45. And I want you to go with me over to verse 19. This is Joseph talking to his brethren. Now thou art commanded, this do ye. This is on their way back to get their father. Take ye out wagons of the land of Egypt for your little ones and for your wives, and bring your father and come. Also regard not your stuff, for the good of all the land of Egypt is yours. That meant everything they needed was at their disposal. And the children of Israel did so, and Joseph gave them wagons according to the commandment of Pharaoh, and look at this, and gave them provision for the way. And so look on down with me in just a few verses over in verse 26. And told him, saying, Joseph is yet alive, and he is governor over all the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart fainted, for he believed them not. And they told him all the words of Joseph which he had said unto them. And listen, and when he saw the wagons which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob their father revived. Listen, he would have never received the wagons if he would have never let go of Benjamin. And you say, well, Brian, what was on those wagons? Oh, thank God, it was the reward for Jacob being willing to give over what he was holding on to. What was on those wagons was the provision provision they needed to make it through their daily life. What was on those wagons was everything they needed to take care of them. You say, Brian, what does that have to do with me? Oh, I'm so you're asking good questions tonight. May I remind you, every good gift and every perfect gift cometh from the Father above. And when you're willing to let go and let God have your life, He will supply your need according to His riches and glory. There is nothing that He won't willingly give to you if you willingly give it all to Him. Hallelujah. He daily will load you with benefits if you're willing to let go. Let go of what's holding you. You're holding on to fear. You're holding on to doubt. Some of you, young men, you're holding on to surrendering the call to preach. Some of you are surrendering the call into mission work. Some of you are surrendering the call into stepping up into ministry. And you're fearful. You're afraid. You say, Brian, I'm not qualified. I wasn't even planning on saying this, but I feel like saying it. May I remind you, God does not call the equipped. He equips the called. And if you're willing just to let weapons, if you're willing to let go, God will blow your mind. Yeah. Hallelujah. They gave him provision. What is that? Provision for the way. Not only gave him enough provision to make it every day, but he gave him enough to make it to his new home. Woo. He said he gave him provision for the way. Where was he headed to? I ain't got time to preach this, but it's good. He was headed to a land of Goshen where they wasn't going to be touched, where every need was going to be taken care of, every need would have been supplied, where the family could stay and live without fear. That's where they were headed. Guess what? It was a brand new country. It was a brand new home where he would live the rest of his life, and he would have never got that provision unless he let go of Benjamin. And listen, God will take care of you. The songwriter said, be not dismayed, whate'er be tied. God will take care of you. But you have to be willing to let go and let God have control of your life. You know, we're a bunch of hypocrites. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus with everything but this. Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus with everything but this. Oh, I just killed a meeting, Chris. I'm sorry. You're holding on to the penny. And God wants to pour you out a blessing you can't contain. I'm not talking about just finances. I'm talking about spiritually tonight. Some of you are holding on to a spiritual penny. And you're thinking, that's all that I need. Listen, God's got so much more. If you just let go. Now think about this. Not only were those the rewards for their provision along the way. Not only did they give him provision, but also gave him direction. Because see, those wagons came from where he was headed to. So those wagons knew the way to get home. So because he was willing to let go of Benjamin, he found the direction to get to his brand new home. And listen, some of you tonight, you have to understand you're trying to do it your own way. You're trying to make your own choices. There are forks in the road and you're not praying about it. You're not letting God have it because you're so impatient. But may I remind you, I would rather wait on the Lord and make the right choice as to go down the wrong road and end up somewhere where God never intended for you to be. And may I remind you, sometimes the shortest way is not always the right way. A couple of weeks ago, the Lohr family and I were in service together down in Hamlin, West Virginia. This area reminds me of Hamlin, West Virginia. A lot of the roads remind me of Hamlin, West Virginia. And so we were traveling down Route 10, which is about like coming from Maryville to here. on that switchback curves and all that. That's about what it was, right? That was the good road to Hamlin, West Virginia. And so, long story short, they needed me to take my truck and to pull their trailer. And then Darren and the rest of the family were following us in a SUV. And so I was, you know, had my phone up there and it was telling me where to go. So, you know, it defaults to the shortest route. I never been to this church. They never been to the church. I've been down Route 10 many times, but I'd never been to the church. So we got to a community there off Route 10 called Salt Rock. And so the Siri kindly says, turn right on Tyler Creek Road. And so I turned right on Tyler Creek Road. The worst decision I've ever made in my life. May I remind you, I am driving a Dodge Ram 1500 with a Hemi in it. I just like to throw that in there. And then I'm pulling their trailer. They're behind me. And we turn off onto a half a road. I'm not even lying. Darren affectionately called it a goat path, and I think he was being kind when he said that. It was only about a mile and a half in order to, actually we, all we had to do was stay on Route 10 because it was just a shortcut to get to Route 10 on the other side. But all we had to do was stay on Route 10, but it said this was the shortest way. So I'm telling you, we traveled over places we never been. I didn't know the road was already narrow, and then it came and said one lane bridge, and I thought, what in the world? And I was laughing because all I could think of was Darren behind me going, where in the world is he leading us to? And so I could hear him back there, and that's exactly what he was doing too. And so I thought, how in the world are we ever? I need to turn around. I couldn't turn around, but see, I thought I knew the way to go. I was just being obedient to what Siri was telling me. But listen, sometimes the shortest route ain't always the best route. And I found out the hard way, that's not the best way to go to Good Hope Free Will Baptist Church. But thank God, I'm glad I'm not following a GPS to get to heaven. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me. And sometimes it ain't the straightest road. Sometimes it ain't the shortest road. But bless God, because I let him guide my life. Hallelujah. He's going to take me to heaven. Yeah. Hallelujah. A reward. He would have never gotten a reward if he hadn't let go of Benjamin. Secondly, he would have never received the revelation if he hadn't let go of Benjamin. What was the revelation? Go back with me to chapter 45 of Genesis. Go back to verse 26. And told him, saying, Joseph is yet alive, and he is the governor over all the land of Egypt. And Jacob's heart fainted, for he believed them not. He actually had a heart attack. He passed out. And they told him all the words of Joseph, which he had said unto them. So the words of Joseph, when he saw the wagons which Joseph had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob, their father, revived. Now, before I go on, let me say this. Joseph is probably the closest typology to Jesus Christ in the Old Testament. He correlates and compares to Jesus Christ better than any Old Testament character. So when you're thinking about what I'm getting ready to tell you, just think Joseph represents Jesus, okay? So they told him all the words of Jesus, which he had sent unto them. And when he saw the wagons which Jesus had sent to carry him, the spirit of Jacob their father revived. And Israel said, it is enough. Jesus my son, Joseph my son is yet alive. I will go and see him before I die. You see, if he would have never let go of Benjamin, he would have never found out the revelation that his son was still alive. Hallelujah. Oh, thank God. Hey, I grew up in church and I heard all my life that Jesus died. And I knew that he died. They told me that he died. The word says that he died. But I didn't believe it until as a 5-year-old boy. I knelt at an altar of prayer and I asked Jesus to come into my heart because I was willing to let go and let God save me. Thank God I found out that 3 days later he rose triumphantly over death, hell, and the grave. And bless God, because I let go. Thank God I that he's alive. Hallelujah. He's alive. And if you're not willing to let go, you'll never know the resurrected Jesus Christ in your heart. You'll never know that he's alive. You'll hear about people telling you that he's alive, but until you experience it for yourself, you'll never know he's alive. The songwriter said, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy and I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives, he lives. Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, he lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives. He lives within my heart. And if you will let go tonight, if you're not saved, if you're willing to let go and let God come into your heart and save you, you'll find out exactly who Jesus is. He's alive. He's alive. He's alive. Hallelujah. He's alive. Glory to God. He's alive. The revelation of the Son, but also the revelation of the Spirit. The Bible says the Spirit, his heart was revived. His spirit was revived in him because he knew that his son was alive. And I'm telling you, there is only some revelation that will only come if you're willing to let go and let the Spirit speak to you. I know I got to hurry, but I got to share this. I've had about three. And believe me, before I say this, I'm not saying this to puff myself up or brag. I'm just telling you what happened to me. There's been three occasions in my life when the Holy Spirit, through dreams or visions, whatever you want to call them, has showed me things, not prophecy, but has showed me things that I didn't understand at the time, but it was to be an encouragement to someone else, people I didn't even know. Sometimes my own family. And I didn't take it lightly. The first time it ever happened to me was about 11 years ago. But in recent years, about 6 years ago, 6 or 7 years ago, I was sleeping, of course, and don't you love how God, you know, everyone kind of jokes, man, I wish he would show me things at 7, 8 o'clock in the morning when I'm already up. But most of the time he shows us in the middle of the night when it's quietest and we can hear the still small voice. And so I was sleeping and all of a sudden I was transported to Crossville, Tennessee to Mike McCoy's church, Brother Chris. And I saw they were singing congregational songs. And Bobby, I looked up on stage and I saw their song leader just singing. I mean, just going nuts. He was singing and rejoicing. At that time, their song leader, his name was Gary Lewis. And I had never met Gary before. I didn't know Gary. All I knew, I'd been in service and I knew he was their song leader. Never spoken to him, didn't know who he was. And so I saw that vision and saw that dream, and he was just shouting and rejoicing. And the Holy Spirit said, when you wake up in the morning, you need to call Brother Mike McCoy at Crossville, and you need to tell him what just happened. Well, can I be honest and say I didn't do that? Number one, because I thought, well, I'm just dreaming. And you know how all of us preachers joke around, we must have ate some chicken before we went to bed or something, you know? I thought, no, I'll just not worry about that. And the Holy Spirit kept prodding me and prodding me. Said, you need to share what you saw. So I waited about 3 days, Bobby, and finally I couldn't handle it anymore. I called Brother Mike and I said, Mike, what I'm about ready to tell you, I'm not crazy, I promise. I said, but what I'm about ready to tell you, this is what I saw, and I got to tell you what happened. So I told him exactly what I dreamed. I said, I saw your song leader. I said, I don't even know his name. I said, I saw your song leader just rejoicing and praising God in one of your services. And that's all I saw. And all of a sudden I heard, Glory to God! Evidently, Micah dropped the phone and went to shouting. And so all I heard him was shouting, and it, obviously he was running around his office. And so I thought, what's going on? So he picked up the phone and said, brother, brother, brother. You know Mike McCoy. Brother, brother, brother. God has spoken to you to help our church. I said, what are you talking about? He said, well, what you don't know is, said Gary and his wife, they're just about ready to end it all. Gary's been so down. He's been so depressed. He's about ready to give up preaching. He's about ready to give up singing. He's about ready to give it all up because they are so down. They're just, things have happened and it's all distraught and they're just about ready. It's all just about ready to be done. He said, now what did you see him do? I said, he was up singing, praising God. He was rejoicing and having victory. He said, you know what? I'll tell him exactly what you told me. And so he got on the phone and called Gary. He called me back. And he said, brother, he's never met you and you've never met him. But God's given you a sign to tell us that everything's going to be okay. Everything's going to be all right. Just hold on. God's given us a strength to make to get through it. Well, I don't know if you know it or not now, but Gary is pastoring over in Nebo, North Carolina. He was here on Monday night. Him and his wife are doing great. Their church is doing great. I'm not telling you it was anything that I did. No, it was nothing that I did. But thank God, if because we were willing to let go and let God speak to us through his spirit. I'm telling you, it's amazing what God can do in your life. The revelation. The revelation. He never would receive that revelation if he hadn't let go of Benjamin. Finally, he would have never had a reunion if he would have never let go of Benjamin. Chapter 46. So Jacob, my son's alive. I will go see him before I die. That's what he said. So they got on the wagons. They took their family and they went back. And the Bible says in chapter 46 of verse 29, and Joseph made ready his chariot and went up to meet Israel, his father to Goshen. And presented himself unto him, and he fell on his neck and wept on his neck a good while. What a reunion. The one that they said was dead, now he found out he was alive, and now he's going to go see him again. And he would have never got to see his son again if he would have never let go of Benjamin. I'm telling you what, folks, we have no idea what's waiting on us on the other side. Oh, our Pastor Calvin Ray preached last night about heaven and just a little taste of what it's going to be like. But I guarantee this right here, there are people waiting on me. There are people waiting on the other side that I've had to say goodbye to. I know they're alive and bless God, I will see them before I die. You say, Brian, what do you mean before you die? Oh, haven't you, don't you know when you're a child of God, you don't die. You just transfer from this life to the next. And bless God, because I let God have his way in my life, there's a reunion coming and I'll see him face to face. Most of all, I'll see the Son of God face to face. The one that died for me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. 4 years ago, came down to this meeting. My heart was heavy. I was burdened heavy. We had just lost, I say lost, but a dear sainted mother in our church who had cancer passed away from her third bout of cancer. Young lady, a great woman of faith. And so Calvin Ray preached about laying your burdens down that night, and the Lords were here. I don't know if they were singing that night specifically, but they were here, and I came down right over there, Chris, and I knelt at the altar, and I said, I can't handle this anymore, Lord. This is hard on a pastor. This is hard on, I just don't understand why it all happened. And she had great faith. And, you know, sometimes there's people that pass away, and you don't understand why God has to take them the way they do. You know there's a reason, but he hadn't revealed it to me yet. And so I just knelt and prayed and just gave it over to God. I felt a peace that everything was going to be okay. And so we went home that night and laid down in the cabin, and Went to sleep, and this is the third time that God has given me something. So in the middle of the night, I dreamed, and I was walking around, and all of a sudden, Norman Wilson of the Primitives is right in front of my face. Norman Wilson had just passed away too. And I didn't get to go to his funeral. We were preaching, and I wanted to go to be a part of his funeral. And I remember that's what I told him. I said, Norman, I'm sorry I wasn't there for your funeral. And Norman's like, oh, that's okay, bud. That's okay. You know Norman. He just, with the Primitives, just a great man of God. And I said, brother, it's so good to see you. And he said, buddy, wait till you get here. That's what he said. I said, and then I remember asking him the question. I said, Norman, what's it like? He said, Brian, it's then and there. And I woke up. And I wrote it down. I wrote it down. I still got the piece of paper at home. I wrote it down, put the date on it. Then and there. And here my heart was already on the lady that had died at our church, and my heart was on Norman Wilson. Just didn't understand a lot of things. I was confused on a lot of things, didn't understand it all. And so Norman gives me these words, I believe, through the Spirit of God, saying then and there. I chewed on that for 2 or 3 days. And then I just did what most people do to find out stuff. I went on the internet, because everything on the internet's true, right? So I put in the words, definition of then and there. And wouldn't you know it, it came up. Definition of then and there. One word, Bobby. Immediately. The light bulb went off. Lord, that's what you've been trying to tell me. The young lady that was a part of our church that had that cancer, when she entered and put through the gates of the city, then and there, that cancer was gone. Then and there, she was finally received that brand new body. When Norma Wilson transferred from this life to the next to when he was bear hunting, then and there, immediately he received a brand new body. And bless God, I know our hearts have been heavy this week as we've been praying for our good buddy Jimmy Russell. But Jimmy, if you're watching tonight, I want you to know and give you assurance from the blessed word of God. To be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. And when you leave this world, immediately, you'll receive a brand new body, free from pain, free from disease, free from heartache, no more death, no more sorrow, no more crying. The former things are all passed away. Aren't you thankful? We're going to then and there. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. No more. No more. No more. Revelation's filled with no mores. He said there's no more sea. But more importantly than that, no more sickness, no more pain, no more sorrow, no more death. Hey, and the Bible says that Jesus himself shall wipe our tears away. Aren't you glad for that day that's coming? But listen, you'll never get to experience then and there until you let go. Until you let go, Benjamin. Jacob would have never got the reunion if he hadn't let go. Let go. What are you holding on to tonight? As they get a song ready, what are you holding on to? What's holding you back from receiving full victory in God? What's God impressed upon you that you're holding on to? You're saying, I can't do this. I can't do it. I'm telling you, if you just come, let go. Remember the old westerns? They'd surround a building, and the sheriff would say, come out! What'd he say? What was the next line? With your hands up. You know what that means? That meant the one that were guilty were coming out with their hands up in surrender. saying, I'm submitting to you, Sheriff. You can take me where you want to take me because I'm submitting to you. My hands are up. And listen tonight, the Holy Spirit says, come out with your hands up. It's time to get them up and say, Lord, here I am. I surrender to you. Whatever you want from my life, I give it to you. If you're holding on to the sins of this world, my friend, nothing's worth losing your soul over tonight. Come and let go of yourself and let God save you and set you free. Your heads are bowed tonight. They're getting ready to sing. There's a one all over this sanctuary tonight, this auditorium, would raise your hand and say, Brian, I do not know the Lord as my personal Savior. I'm holding on to the things of the world. I'm holding on to myself. I'm afraid of what my friends will think when I get saved. I'm afraid of what my family will think. I'm afraid of what my spouse will think. I'm just afraid. I just don't know. Listen, my friend, the fear is coming straight from Satan. God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. If you come and just give it to him, just give it all. You don't even have to say a word. He understands everything that goes on between your heart and heaven. The Holy Spirit understands all of it. But if you don't know the Lord, could you raise your hand? Everybody on the floor, if you don't know the Lord, would you raise your hand tonight, Brian? Pray for me. Pray for me. Anybody? How about up in the balcony? Anyone? Brian, I need Jesus. I need to be saved. Well, I'm not going to ask for hands from those of the church that maybe holding on to something. You know if you're holding on to something or not. You know if there's some things holding you back. If there's some insecurity in your life. Benjamin was fear. Benjamin was doubt. Benjamin was actually, Jacob was holding on to himself through his son. If you just come and let go, God's setting you up for some miraculous things in your life. If you just come and let go. Let's stand. They're going to sing. Would you use these altars tonight? Let go of Benjamin. Let go of Benjamin. Oh, God, help us.
Come, you sinners, poor and needy. Come, ye wounded, weak and worn. There's a harbor for the broken, where the hopeless are. Forgotten, let your wandering soul find rest. At your heart's door, he is knocking for you. His precious blood was shed. He is able, he is able. Christ is able still to save. Sinners, poor and needy,
come on tonight.
Sing to him our song of praise.
Mind the Lord.
Come to ransom.
Come and surrender.
And forgiven. Come to rest. Come. Rise and worship. Rise. Thank you.
They're still praying. Go ahead and sing another song, whatever you have on your heart. God is able. Do you believe that? He's able. Whatever you have in your heart, whatever burdens you're carrying tonight, He is able. No need to walk out of here with them on your shoulder. You say, Brian, well, I know I can take care of this. Listen, my friend, you may be able to, but honestly, you can't handle it. You can't handle it. There's nothing too big for God. But if you don't turn it over to Him, it'll come big. Bigger than what you can think or imagine. Why don't you give it to Him now? Lord, direct my steps, guide me. I promise you, He's able. Sing one more verse.
Just as I am without one plea, but that
yes,
Thy blood was shed for me, and that
yes,
Thou
bidst bless your heart,
me.
Bless your heart.
Oh God, I come.
Come just as you are tonight.
Just as I am and waiting not to rid my soul.
God good. I hope you let go of your Benjamin tonight. And I'm not talking about the offering. What a great night the Lord give us. And I'm telling you, I really want you to spend some time in prayer when you leave here tonight. You know, we have church for a reason. We have church to worship. How many of you worship tonight? But you know, there's another reason why we gather, and that is we gather that someone might be saved. Now, I understand. I know all the cliches. I've been in church for most of my life. I want to tell you something tonight. The Bible says, compel them to come in that my house may be filled, full, overflowing. We've got a job to do. And when we have revival, it's good for the church to get revived, but God wants us to use His Spirit that He gives us to go out and compel the lost to come in that they might be saved. And you know, there's a lot of times, Brother Brian, that I think we're holding on to some little thing that'll keep us from compelling someone. I've never seen a day whenever that young people won't ask other young people to come to the house of God because those other young people that they've been with have heard the way they've spoken, have seen the way that they've acted. And I also believe that in the day we're living in, that there's a lot of people in the workplace that they can't ask their co-workers to come to church with them because they're ashamed of how they've acted Monday through Saturday. But you know, God is raising up a remnant right now that's not ashamed to stand, not ashamed to speak up and to step out. And I don't know if you see it or not, but God's doing something through the unity of the churches in the area. Because see, what we all have to come to grips with is that there are going to be other people from different churches that's going to heaven. There's going to be different people. If you're in an independent, there's going to be people from different camps that go to heaven. There's going to be different people from different denominations that go to heaven, because it is by and through the blood of Jesus Christ. That's it. Let's do our best to pray. Go ahead and give Him praise. He's worthy. He's worthy of our praise. We can't praise Him enough. But my heart is burdened for those that are lost. Ennis Dockery told me something about 2 weeks ago with tears in his eyes as we stood in a classroom in Murphy Middle School. He said, "Preacher, I'm telling you, there's something that we've all got to understand." I said, "What's that?" And he said, "Number one, Jesus is coming." I said, "Yes, He is. I agree with that." He said, "Number two," he said, "we've got to understand it's imminent that He's coming. He could come at any second, at any moment." And friends, brothers and sisters, according to your testimony tonight, every single person in here is saved. That's a good thing if you are. And I know sometimes people are not totally honest, but it is our duty when we go from this place to be able to tell someone tonight by a text, an email, by a call, on social media, sharing the service to encourage someone else. That is our duty in the day we're living in, to tell others about our coming Savior. Also, tomorrow, we're to continue to do that. Matter of fact, I'm going to ask you to do something and make a promise that when you leave here tonight, some way, form, or fashion, that you're going to touch base with somebody in your community, in your area, in your school, and you're going to ask them to come to this meeting. Can I see your hand? I'll do that. I just gave you several different ways. Everybody's hand should have been up. You just missed the whole part of the sermon that I just said it's our duty to go and do that. That's our duty. I'm not preaching at you. I'm preaching with you. It's our job. And see, if we can come together in unity in the Lord, then in unity we can go from this place to unify someone that is not going to heaven to the body of Christ. That's our call as the church. Did you enjoy Brian Bear's preaching tonight? Do you love him? Come on. Let him feel the love.
Love you.
I want you to go by the McCamey's table out here. And also, we mentioned the other night, if you would like to go to Israel next year, if you're interested in that, please, if you're a pastor, see me about that. If you're interested in going on the Singing at Sea cruise with some of your favorite artists in gospel music, we would love to have you go with us. There's a table out there with that information on there. And we would love for you to go and enjoy a great time of the year in January, starting off the year right. Church, you ought to send your pastor, because pastors have a tough time. Amen. Pastors need a lot of prayer. And pastors need pampered once in a while. Amen. All right, we love you. Listen, be careful tonight when you leave here. It's raining hard, has been through the service, storming.
Watch out for trees.
Watch out for trees, amen. You better make sure you've been to one tree. We had a rededication to the Lord tonight, amen. Praise be unto the Lord. Let's reach out. We got work to do, church. Tomorrow night will be Dr. Joe Arthur. How many of you have never heard Dr. Joe? Oh, my goodness. You better be here tomorrow night. You don't want to miss him. What about the Mike Bowling family? I've never heard them before. Oh, it's going to be on tomorrow night, folks. You don't want to miss it. We love you. God bless you. Be safe. Let's get our hands up in the air. Let's exercise. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. God bless you. Be safe and good night.